Good morning, everybody. Good morning, and welcome back to once again to our brand new series on the most expected 50 questions from entire full syllabus of biology, botany, and zoology of class 11th and class 12th for NEET 2021. I hope you all can hear me properly. And the screen is perfectly clear for each one of you over here. So without wasting our precious time, we are moving on to the session. Okay, so we have to discuss 50 most expected questions. Okay, actually, a practice paper is which we are going to do. So I am going to tell you about 50 most expected questions, which I feel that these could be asked for the exam. Okay, some are HOTS questions, that is a high level order question. Maybe if the question paper proved to be, or a question paper is made to be a harder or a bit difficult than how we expected. So such kinds of questions are also included. So we have to discuss 50 questions, and we won't be doing a detailed explanation for each and everything. For those questions, for example, source question coming from genetics, or those needs any numerical calculation, or which needs any detailed explanation, for those questions only we would be just explaining it deeply, and rest of the answers you have to get ready with your OMR sheets for 50 marks, 50 bubbles or 50 questions OMR sheet. I have already posted a 60 questions OMR sheet in the group. So with that 50 expected questions which we are going to do, so get ready with your OMR sheet, and as soon as a question appear on the screen, you can start bubbling your OMRs, and at last you can count and tell me on the comment section how many marks have you got at last. So let's start with this brand new series on this Monday morning, 50 most expected questions from botany and zoology for our dear NEET 2021 batch. Those who are watching the session right now, don't forget to hit the like button, to share it with your friends, and subscribe this amazing platform for more classes and more quizzes. This is our Telegram group, t.me/neet_bio.point, where daily session updates, regular discussion, polls, quizzes, and interact with us takes place. So without wasting any more time in these things, we are going to start with this most expected 50 questions. Okay. One second. Let me take out the pen. Yes. So guys, let's get started. I'll be giving you 30 seconds to answer one mark questions. That is short answer type questions, and for statement based question, 1 minute would be allotted. Okay, so let's start with question number one on the screen. Question number one on the screen. Question number one, for transformation, microparticles coated with DNA to be bombarded from gene gun are made up of. For transformation, question from biotechnology principles and processes. For transformation, microparticles coated with DNA to be bombarded from a gene gun are made up of. Okay, I am telling the answer. Guys, this is a question from biotechnology. There you have studied different methods of transferring a vector or a DNA segment into a host or a vector. So one of them was the gene gun or the biolistic method. One of them was the gene gun or the biolistic method. In which the DNA is being incorporated into microscopic gold or tungsten. Okay, DNA is being incorporated into gold or tungsten or titanium particles as bullets into the living tissue. Okay, Yes, Calvin. I can see your charts. Yes, option D is the correct answer. So, gold or tungsten is the answer. Gene gun or biolistic, in which the microparticles coated with DNA are being turned into small bullets. Okay, microparticles coated with DNA is turned into small bullets and they are accelerated at a very high velocity into the host tissue. So the correct answer is option D, gold or tungsten. I'll provide the PDF. Okay, I'll provide the PDF. Okay, next question. Question number two. Depending upon the distance between any two genes, which is inversely proportional to the strength of linkage, crossovers will vary from. Depending upon the distance between any two genes, which is inversely proportional to the strength of linkage, crossovers will vary from. Crossovers will vary from. Is it 100 to 150? Is it 100 to 150? I'll tell you. The strength and distance. Guys, listen very carefully. Distance between any two genes. Distance between two genes. Distance between two genes is inversely proportional to the strength. Okay. Inversely proportional to the strength of the linkage. That is, you can tell, like, as the distance between the genes increases, the strength of linkage, as the distance between the genes increases, the strength of the linkage decreases. Okay, so greater the distance, lower will be the linkage strength. So the linkage can have, or the linkage is broken down at the time of crossing overs. Okay, the strength of the linkage is broken down due to the phenomenon of crossing overs, which takes place at the time of meiosis. So crossing over will be relatively more frequent if the distance between the two genes is more than in case where the distance between the two genes is lesser. Okay, so in this case, we can tell the correct answer for the question is option B, 0 to 50%. Okay, you have to by heart it. Depending on the distance between any two genes, which is inversely proportional to the strength of the linkage, the crossovers, guys, there are crossovers and non-crossovers are there. For crossovers, you can tell, like, for crossovers, that strength of the linkage or the crossovers will vary from 0 to 50%. Okay, from 0 to 50%. And this particular strength of the crossover will never exceed 50%. But in case of non-crossovers, you can tell, like, it is to be 50 to 100%. But you have to by heart this particular thing. For crossovers, the strength of linkage is 0 to 50%. What happened, Nandana, Anil Kumar? The answer was correct. Option B is the correct answer. Okay, so the correct answer is 0 to 50%. Next, question number 3 on your screens. Sertoli cells are found in. Sertoli cells are found in. Very easy question. Yes, Calvin, that's why I'm putting the correct mark over there in the answers so that I can download the PDF. Okay. I'll give you this PDF as well as the detailed explanation for these questions. Okay, detailed explanatory answers for each question I would be giving you. Very easy question. There is no need for further discussions. Question number 3, the answer is option C. Seminiferous tubules. So Sertoli cells are found inside the seminiferous tubule and secrete nutrients for the germ cell. Guys, just imagine this circle as the seminiferous tubule. Okay, This circle has the seminiferous tubule, you suppose. Inside the seminiferous tubule, you have the germ cell or the mother cells. Spermatogonia. Okay. Yes, Calvin, I can see your charts. Yes. So, spermatogonial cell is this. So, inside the seminiferous tubule itself, you will find one more cell, that is the Sertoli cells. What is the function of Sertoli cells? The Sertoli cell will nourishes this spermatogonial cells to produce more sperms or gametes. And one more important thing which you have to note, outside the seminiferous tubule in the interstitial spaces, you have the Leydig cells. You have the Leydig cells or the interstitial cells which can produce the male sex hormone or testosterone. So the correct answer for the question is option number B. Seminiferous tubule secretes nutrients for the germ cells. Question number 4 is a diagram based question. You can easily answer this question. Easily you can answer this question. Yes, I'll give you 30 seconds to find the answer for this question. What do A, B, C, D in the diagram represent? What is A, guys? A is the infundibulum, right? A is the infundibulum. A is the infundibulum. Next, what is B? B is the process of fertilization happening. But guys, actually this arrow can be actually marked to over here. Then we can tell it to be the B, fertilization. But as per the option, only fertilization is given. Okay. Look, actually whole B option is given like fertilization. So we are asked to go like B is fertilization. But in the diagram, if you look clearly, you can tell like this diagram. This is actually the diagram which is indicating the process of fertilization. Okay, since the question demands for option B is always fertilization, we have to go like that. So A is infundibulum. So two options are there, A or B should be the answer. So you can omit option C, cannot be the answer. Option D also cannot be the answer. B is fertilization. Then what is C? C is the internal layer of the uterus. So it is endometrium. So in this case, you can cut endometrium. So in the option A, it is given myometrium. So the correct answer for the question is option number B, infundibulum, fertilization, endometrium, and the blastocyst. So option D is the blastocyst. I hope it's clear. Give me a thumbs up on the chat box if it's clear. If it's clear, give me a thumbs up on the chat box. No way, no chats. What happened? Hope you can hear me properly and the answer and the question is clear. Question number 5 on the screen. Copper ions released from copper releasing IUDs from intrauterine devices. What is actually the function? Very easy question. Copper ions released. I have taken the class 2 days or 3 days ago on reproductive health. Read the question very carefully. Direct statement from the NCRT. Copper ions released from the copper releasing IUDs. I am not asking the general procedure or general function of IUDs. Specifically mentioned copper releasing IUDs, copper 3, copper 7. What is actually their function? In your NCERT textbook, it is clearly mentioned copper ions are released from copper releasing IUDs. And what are their function? They suppresses the sperm motility. They suppresses the sperm motility and the cervix hostile to the sperms. Okay, so only one option is provided. So suppresses sperm motility will be the correct answer. Increases the phagocytosis of the sperm is the general function of IUDs. Is the general function of IUDs, right? The second sentence in the copper releasing IUDs, where the second function given, the first is they increases the phagocytosis of the sperms. Second one, they suppresses the sperm motility and makes the cervix hostile to the sperms. So that is actually the function of copper releasing IUDs. Copper ions suppresses the sperm motility. So that is the answer. Fifth one, answer is option C. Okay, remember that. Copper ion. So two functions are there. Suppresses sperm motility, makes the cervix hostile to the sperms. Makes the cervix hostile to the sperms. So two functions, you have to be careful. Next, question number six. A question from the chapter evolution. Very easy question if you know the concept. Very easy question if you know the concept or still remember the concept. Which one of the following correctly describes the homologous structure? So just imagine what is, or just think what are homologous structures. So the answer is there. What is homologous structure? Answer is there on the option. We have studied their homologous structure, analogous structure, divergent evolution, convergent evolution, adaptive radiation, all those things we have studied in the chapter of evolution. So first term which we studied over there is a homologous structure. What is homologous structures? Don't know. Homologous structures are there. Analogous structures are there. Homologous. Homologous means they have same anatomical structures. It's not B. Its answer is A. Okay. Sixth one, answer is A. Homologous structures have same anatomical structures. Okay. Same anatomical structure, but different function. Okay. So organs with different functions, but they have the similar origin is referred to as the homologous structure. What are analogous structures? Analogous structures is organs with anatomical dissimilarities, but performing the similar function. So that makes the difference between homologous structures and analogous structure. Okay. Analogous structures means the anatomically they are different, but their function is the same. But homologous structures means their anatomical structure is the same, or their evolution is from a common ancestor, but they are performing different function. Give me thumbs up on the chat box if this answer is clear. If you understood the answer for this question, give me thumbs up on the chat box. Yes. Question number seven on your screen. Once again, an easy question from the chapter Human Health and Disease. Okay. Human Health and Disease, one of the commonly and frequently repeated part of the chapter, spread of malarial parasite by Plasmodium vivax. A person suffering from a disease caused by Plasmodium. Guys, what is that disease? What is that disease caused by Plasmodium? Malaria. Right? What is that disease? It is malaria. Experiences recurring chill and fever at the time when? Easy question. I'm waiting for your answers. Easy question. Easy question. A person suffering. Like in the time of malaria, at a particular point of time of malaria, what happens is like, a person or experiencing or suffering from the disease malaria will experience recurring chill and fever. Recurring chill and fever. So guys, be careful When is a person experiencing recurring chill and fever? Guys, we studied that the malarial parasite or the plasmodium, if this is the RBC. Okay, guys, this is the RBC, you suppose. Yes, Calvin, hemozoin is a toxin responsible for it. Then why you have told me the answer as option B? Why is the answer option B? Guys, the plasmodium. This plasmodium will enter into this RBC and it will spread out. Okay, it will multiply and it will form a huge number. Okay. Huge number of plasmodium vivax are formed inside the RBC. We cannot tell that. The concept behind it should be cleared. The concept should be clear behind it. Okay. So it is actually multiplying. And at one point of time, what happens is like the RBC ruptures. Okay. The RBC ruptures and releases this toxin inside it, which is known as hemozoin, as you told me. Okay. So hemozoin is actually the toxin which is responsible for the recurring chill and fever at the time of malarial fever. But we have to be more specific to the answer. Okay, so the parasite, after a rapid multiplication inside the RBC, ruptures and enter into a stage to form fresh RBC. So guys, this hemozoin is, I'll tell you in a very simple way. Hemozoin is the toxin or the toxic substance which causes this recurring chill and fever. Is it clear? Hemozoin is responsible for the recurring chill and fever. Is this sentence clear? Is it clear? I hope it's clear. Look at the second statement given over here. The tropozoids reaches maximum growth and given out the toxin. It's not correct because the tropozoids are not giving out the toxins. Okay, the tropozoid stage is not giving out the toxin. The toxin is released as the RBC ruptures. In the NCERT textbook, it's clearly given like the RBC ruptures releasing a very highly toxic substance, which is called hemozoin, which is responsible for the recurring chill and fever. Calvin, is it clear? Or should I repeat these same once again? Is it clear? So the correct answer for the question is option C. The parasite, after its rapid multiplication inside the RBC, ruptures them, releasing the stage to enter fresh RBC. Okay, you have to be, you know, the term toxin is there. You know, you have the idea about it, but you are not remembering the sentence given in the NCERT. That's the problem. Okay. Because you have told me the answer and all the related reasons with that also. But you got confused. How was it released? In our NCERT textbook also, the thing is not given in a well detailed manner. In some reference guides and all, you will find a separate topic about this plasmodium. In NCERT only a very few. And all the rest of the things we have to understand with that particular diagram in the NCERT. Right? So if you refer some reference books or guides or something, you will find a detailed explanation. But no need to go for all those things. We have to be sticking to our NCERT. So we'll be able to do the questions which come. Okay. So this hemozoin toxin is released as RBC ruptures. Question number 8 on the screen. Very easy question again. Very easy question. Number of histone proteins in each nucleosome core is? Question from the chapter Molecular Basis of Inheritance. Questions from the chapter Molecular Basis of Inheritance. Please don't make it lag. Okay, tell me the answer fast. Yes, the correct answer for the question is option number A. Answer is option A, 8. Okay, 8 histone proteins are present in each nucleosome core. Okay. What is actually nucleosome? What is a nucleosome? Tell me, what is a nucleosome? What is a nucleosome? Nucleosome is the basic unit of DNA packaging. Okay, nucleosome is a basic unit of DNA packaging. Okay, we studied like octamer. We studied in the chapter of DNA, nucleosome explanation of the term octamer. Right, so the histone proteins are arranged as octamers, or eight different proteins, or eight, not eight different protein. There are four different histone proteins which are paired. Okay, 2 × 4, which is actually 8. Okay, we don't have to go in detail about all those things. There is H2A, H2B, all those things are there, but we should not go into detail. So the correct answer for the question is option number A, 8. Question number 9. Easy question from biodiversity and conservation. Sacred groves are specially useful in. Okay, don't make it lag. Tell me the answer fast. Sacred groves are usually found or useful in. Sacred groves are usually useful in. Sacred groves are useful in. No answers. Don't know. What happened? Don't know the answer. Yes, correct. The answer for question number 9 is D. Conserving rare and threatened species. For conserving the threatened species, for conserving the extinct species which are under the extinction. So those species conservation is done by sacred groves or botanical garden. Different things which we studied in the chapter biodiversity and conservation. Different ways of conserving the extinct and the threatening species we have studied. So sacred groves, among this, we have to know that sacred groves are used for conserving rare and threatened species. Question number 10. Very important question. Question number 10. Some important events in the human female reproductive systems are shown below. Arrange the events in a proper sequence. Calvin, I don't know whether you are there. I have not received your answer for question number 9. A is secretion of FSH. B is growth of corpus luteum. C is the growth of follicle and oogenesis. D, ovulation. And E is the sudden increase in the level of LH. So let's start. First of all, in the human female reproductive cycle, secretion of FSH happens, right? Secretion of FSH from the anterior pituitary gland happens. And what does it show? This secretion of FSH leads to the growth of follicle and oogenesis happens, right? So secretion of FSH happens, then growth of follicle and oogenesis happens, right? After that, after the growth of follicle and oogenesis, ovulation happens. Before ovulation, we have one more important thing, the sudden increase in the level of LH surge, right? LH surge happens. Due to LH surge, ovulation happens, and finally after ovulation, the corpus luteum is formed. So the correct answer for question number 10 is option number D. It is A, C, E, D, B. Hope it's clear. Moving on to question number 11. We have 40 more questions, so please be fast. A twisting question. As per my perspective, maybe they can ask, but chances are very less. Okay, chances for this question to come for your exam is very less. Okay, because they don't just twist you with these kinds of tricky ones. Since you are going to write your exam on 2021. You won't expect a question like this, but anyway, let's do it. So given natural selection, variations and inheritance, survival of the fittest, struggle for existence. According to Darwinism, which of the following represents the correct sequence of events in the origin of new species? According to Charles Darwin and his theory Darwinism, which of the following represents the correct sequence of events in the origin of new species? So as per his theory, a detailed explanation, they have told, like, first of all, for the origin of a species, there should be a struggle for existence. There should be a struggle for existence. After the struggle for existence, certain variations may come. So as a part of the variation, there may be some kind of variation or differences which are useful, may be inherited. After this, variations are inherited, the fittest organism, that is organism which can adapt to that particular environment, would survive, and that would be naturally selected. So the correct answer is 11. Answer is D. 11. Answer is D. Struggle for existence, variations and their inheritance, survival of the fittest, natural selection. Calvin, I'm not finding any of your answers. I don't know whether you are coming. I saw you're okay over there. After that, I found no answers. If it's not clear, please do ask me frankly over here, so that I can clear it at this moment itself. Question number 12. This is also one other question from a high order thinking level question from the chapter Evolution. There are two opposing views about the origin of modern man. According to one view, Homo erectus in Asia were the ancestors of modern man. According to one view, Homo erectus in Asia were the ancestors of modern man. A study of variation of DNA, however, suggested that African origin of modern man. What kind of observation on DNA variation could suggest this? Don't know. Don't get panic after seeing the question. The correct answer is option B. Greater variation in Africa than in Asia. Greater variation in Africa than in Asia. Because greater variation means that evolution is happening. Greater variation means that evolution is happening in that particular place. And that evolution may lead to different coexisting forms. Okay. Greater variation means that evolution is happening, and that evolution may turn to different forms or means or different patterns of the same coexisting person or coexisting individual. So from such a situation, the organism may migrate to different population. Okay, may migrate to different population. So the correct answer for this question is greater variation in Africa than in Asia. Hope it's clear. Nobody is responding, so I'm not sure whether you have got the answer for this question or you're still confused about the same. I thought it was my problem. I refreshed the page, but I haven't. Now also, I'm not receiving any of your chats. Yes. Is it clear now? This question will not come for your exam because this is a high order level question. So we are not expecting this kind of a question. Okay, we are not expecting this kind of a question for our exam. Anyway, I'll explain it. Guys, great. There are two opposing views. Read the question very carefully. According to one view, Homo erectus in Asia were the ancestors of modern man. So according to one theory, they are telling like Homo erectus, which was in Asia, are the modern or the ancestors of modern man. Another study of variation of DNA, however, suggested that African origin of modern man, Africa, from Africa is the modern man originating. So the question is demanding you for asking, what kind of observation on DNA variation could suggest this? What kind of observation on DNA variation could suggest this? So greater variation happening means what? Evolution is happening. So where is greater variation happening? That is, we already studied, or we already know that Homo erectus in Asia were the modern ancestors of modern man. But certain DNA technology or DNA variation studies have proved that the similar kind of people or similar kind of individuals are found in Africa also. So where are they evolving, or where are the evolution happening right now? In Africa. So when evolution is happening, what happens? Evolution to takes place, there should be great variation where evolution is more. Greater variation means greater evolution. So greater variation is taking place in Africa. So evolution is happening in Africa. So the correct answer is greater variation in Africa than in Asia. I hope it's clear. Moving on to question number 13. Easy question from the chapter Human Health and Disease. Heroin is extracted from Erythroxylum coca, Cannabinoid sativa, Papaver, Somniferum, Atropha, Belladonna. Heroin is obtained from or extracted from what is actually heroin, guys? What is actually heroin? Heroin is chemical. Heroin, we call, another name is given in the NCERT. Heroin is also known as MAC. Heroin is also known as MAC, or it is called diacetylmorphine. MAC or diacetylmorphine, it is a white, odorless, bitter, crystalline compound which is obtained from the acetylation of morphine. Heroin is also called diacetylmorphine. It is obtained. It is a white, powdery substance which is obtained by the acetylation of morphine, which is extracted from the leaf of the plant Papaver somniferum. Papaver somniferum. So the correct answer for the question is option number C, Papaver somniferum. It is actually coming under the class of opioids. Okay, question number 14, a pedigree chart. Very, very important question. Study the given pedigree chart of a certain family and select the correct conclusion which can be drawn from the character. Guys, this is the male parent and this is the female parent, right? But if you look at, this is the first generation. If you look at the progeny or generation, what happens? This is a daughter, this is a son. So both daughters as well as sons are equally affected. So for both the son or the male and female to be equally affected, what should be the condition? For to have both sons as well as daughters showing the trait, both parents should have at least one copy of the allele. Okay, one single copy of the allele. In the given pedigree chart, female parent is shown normal. So we can tell, as the condition is demanding for male parent is affected, but the female parent is unaffected. That is, it is shown like that. So similarly, similarly, in all the generation, you will find that both males as well as females are equally affected. So for both males and females has to be affected, then the condition is like both parents should have at least one copy of the gene or the allele, at least one copy. So in the given pedigree, female parent is shown normal, which makes her heterozygous. I already told both parents should be, this parent is affected, right? This parent is affected, but this parent is normal, right? So we know that this female parent is heterozygous. Female parent should be heterozygous, right? Then only it may possess one gene or one allele for that problem. Since the particular given pedigree chart is of a recessive trait, it is not expressed in a heterozygous female, but the male parent is homozygous recessive. Guys, just imagine if this is the gene for color blindness, X, it's not for color blindness. Okay. It is not for color blindness. Okay. In certain condition, color blindness can also happen. Okay. Color blindness can also happen like this, but the male parent is X, one chromosome. Why? So since one chromosome of X contains this, it is expressed and the male is affected. But in case of female, this is dominant, this is recessive. I hope it's clear. So the correct answer for the question is female parent is heterozygous. So the correct answer is option number A, female parent is heterozygous. I hope it's clear. Question number 15 on the screen. A mixture containing DNA fragments A, B, C, and D with molecular weights of A plus B equals C, A greater than B, B greater than C was subjected to agarose gel electrophoresis. The position of these fragments from cathode to anode is, from cathode to anode. What is cathode? Positive. Sorry, cathode is negative. Anode is positive. Okay. So this is what you have to remember, because this is the trick of the question. So you have to arrange this from position of cathode to anode. So position, we studied in the chapter biotechnology, like the position of these DNA fragments on electrophoresis, gel electrophoresis, depends upon their molecular weight. The fragment with very less molecular weight moves towards the cathode, right? Right? So we know that the greatest molecular weight is for D. Greatest molecular weight is for D, because D is even greater than C. What is actually C? A plus B is C. So molecular mass of A plus molecular mass of B is actually the molecular mass of C. So molecular mass of D is even greater than the molecular mass of C. Okay. So D is to be greater. After that, C is the summation of A plus B. So C should be written. Then A is greater than B. So A, then finally B, which reflects the answer as option number A. D, C, A, B is the answer. Next. Question number 16, easy one. Which of the following representation shows the pyramid of numbers in a forest ecosystem? Which of the following shows the representation shows the pyramid of numbers in a forest ecosystem? In our NCERT textbook, it has been clearly mentioned The pyramid of numbers is a spindle shape. The pyramid of numbers in a forest is spindle shaped. Okay. Calvin, I don't know whether you have told this C or this C. If you are telling this C, then it should be wrong. This is the answer. Sorry, guys. One second. I think the question is mixed. Which of the following representation shows the pyramid of number in a forest ecosystem? Yes, you can go with option number B. Okay, spindle shaped would be obtaining. You would obtain a spindle shape. It is given in the NCRT. Okay, so go thoroughly with the NCRT. So answer is option number D. Next, easy question again. Environmental issue chapter. When domestic sewage mixes with river water, what is happening? Easy one. When wastewater is mixing with river water, what happens? Microbes will be there, right? The amount of microbes in those will be increasing. So that increased microbial activity will be using up the dissolved oxygen. Eutrophication or algal bloom, all those things you can tell. Okay, so the correct answer is option number C. Increased microbial activity uses up the dissolved oxygen. Guys, sewage, domestic sewage contains microbes, right? That is why it is wastewater. So that wastewater, when it is mixing with the river water, the increased microbial activity will use up the dissolved oxygen. Question number 18. Again, easy question. No need of much thinking for this question. An improved variety of transgenic basmati rice. Transgenic. Guys, if you are there, please tell me the answer. If you are watching or if anybody is hearing, please comment me the answer. Or else I'll be telling the answer like you know the answer. That's why you are keeping quiet. Transgenic basmati rice. Okay, so transgenic basmati, we already studied that transgenic basmati rice, vitamin A, right? Biofortification also we studied, yes, vitamin A enriched food items, vitamin A enriched food items. So the correct answer is option B, gives high yield and is rich in vitamin A. Question number 19, again, an easy and a direct question from NCRT. Cry2AB and Cry1AC. Cry2AB and Cry1AB produce toxin that control. Cry2AB and Cry1AB produce toxin that control. Guys, we know that Cry2AB is always. Cry2AB controls what? Cotton bollworm, right? Cotton bollworm and Cry1AB controls cotton borer. Cotton borer. Is it clear? So 19th one answer is option number A. So Cry2AB controls cotton bollworms and Cry1AB controls corn borer. So the correct answer is 19th answer is A. It is very easy. In my mind, when I put this question or when I just made this slide, in my mind also, it came like this can be a NEET 2021 question. Because I think the same question was asked. Like, cry to AB, cry one AB. The same thing was asked for your knee 2020 also. For knee 2020 also, the same question came. So when I made this, it's a frequently repeated question. So I thought the same question, actually, this is my prediction, may not be the actual structure or something. I'm telling, okay, so please read that portion of BT Cotton very clearly. Okay, maybe a question may come. A 4 marks simply you can get from that. Every year they'll ask a question, and definitely from the chapter biotechnology, 2 or 3 question may come. So from that second chapter, definitely one all the year they'll ask a question on the basis of this particular topic, that is BT Cotton. So this is called cotton bollworm and corn borer. Okay, that's important. Next, question number 20. Okay, no need of going into different crosses or something. Simply we can write. In Mendelian dihybrid cross, when heterozygous round yellow are self-crossed, round green offsprings are represented by the genotype. Are represented by the genotype. Guys, what is given over here? Round green. Look, round yellow. So option could be omitted. Round green. Okay. Round yellow. Sorry, round green. Ringled green. So that option could also be omitted. When coming into option D, round yellow. So that could also be omitted. So the correct answer is option C. Anyone is having doubt? Hetero, guys, tell me, what is heterozygous round yellow? What is heterozygous round yellow? Heterozygous round yellow. Heterozygous means round, capital R, small r, capital Y, small y, right? Heterozygous round. Heterozygous round yellow. Similar way, in the similar way, you can write this too. Look, round green. I'll take out a new slide. We can also write round green, right? Round can be represented. This round can be represented by capital R, or capital R, small r. Both these are representing round. Green is always represented by small y, since it is the recessive. Calvin, I don't know whether you are understanding anything. Ananya, I don't know whether you are understanding anything. Unless you speak out something, I will not be able to understand whether you are understanding anything or whether you are simply wasting your time. I don't know. Until you just speak about something, whether you have understood what I am telling, whether you tell me any answers, then only I'll be able to explain. If you are going wrong, then only I'll be able to explain the right answers. Simply keeping quiet, so I cannot do anything. I have told you, take in the beginning itself, I have told you, take out with your OMR, start bubbling over there, and finally calculate your score. If you guys are behaving like this, next time onwards, these kinds of question discussion won't happen for sure. If you speak out wrong also, then I am here to correct it. If you keep quiet, then I'll think that, yes, you know the answer, you are okay. You're not at all telling me whether the answer is clear, whether the question, my explanation is clear. Simply keeping quiet. I don't know what's happening on the other side. Okay, so here you can write capital R, cap, small y is green, round green. Capital R, small y is also round green. So the correct answer for this question is option number C. Okay. Calvin, then only I'll be able to explain, right? How many answers? Look, how many answers I have skipped without even explaining. Because I thought you know the answer. That's why keeping quiet. If you tell wrong answers only, then I'll be able to correct it. Otherwise, I'll think that you are correct. Suppose if you tell the answer is to be B for this question, then only I'll be explain. Then only there is what? A meaning for explanation. Right? Why? Then only I'll be also explaining it in the same way. Why that child have thought like option B? Oh, since capital R and capital Y, then only I'll be able to explain. Whatever, be it wrong, you tell the answer, you speak up. This is not an E2021 real examination, right? Here, platforms, you're going to study only, right? If you go on wrong in this question, will you lose any marks in an E2021? No, you will gain your marks. You'll gain a plenty of marks if you make mistake right now. If we do not make any mistake right now and we are accumulating the mistake for making it in the last 3 hours, what is the use? Make the mistake right now. Master at the end. And don't master now and make mistake at the end. Okay. Frankly speak up. Whatever be the mistake, I'll be explaining. Question number 21. Next, upcoming questions are a bit difficult, so listen very carefully and be active. In a double-stranded DNA, the sequence of nucleotides in one strand is 3-ATTCGCTAT5-. What will be the complementary sequence on the other strand? What would be the complementary sequence on the other strand? Simply, you can write like 3-ATTCGCTAT. Guys, if this kind of question comes for your exam, make sure you copy down in your answer booklet. Not in your answer booklet, in the question. Otherwise, you have to write here itself the complementary sequence. If you take it down onto a separate place, make sure you copy each and every letters very carefully. If you miss one, you will lose the marks. Guys, complementary strand, 5-. A, complementary is DNA. It's not RNA, DNA. So, adenine, thymine, guanine, cytosine, they should be interchanged. Adenine interchanged with thymine. Thymine interchanged with adenine. Thymine, again adenine, cytosine interchanged with guanine, cytosine, guanine, adenine, thymine, adenine, 3-. What is the answer? TAA, GC, GATA, B is the answer, right? Very easy one. You will familiarize this question. You will come across this question again in the same session itself. How can it be C, Calvin? How can it be C? Listen, I'll explain once again. This is the sequence. What is the complementary? What is the complementary for A? It's T. Look, read the question. They are not asking you about mRNA or double strands or whatever. They are asking you about the complementary sequence of this DNA segment. Complementary sequence. So you have to write the complements of each other. 3-changes to 5-. T A A GCGATA, 3-, option B. I hope now it's clear. I think in the upcoming question, into next two or three questions after, we'll come across a sequence will be given like this, and you'll be asked to write the sequence on the mRNA. So in the RNA sequence, you won't find thymine, you will find only uracil. So at that time, I'll tell you. So option B is the correct answer. Next. Which of the following statement is correct? Which of the following statements are correct? This is also a HOTS question, a high level question. Okay, high level question. Be very careful about this question, then only you'll be able to answer. If you're 200% paka clear on the chapter molecular basis, you will be easily able to do this question. RNA polymerase 1, RNA polymerase 2, RNA polymerase 3. Is it clear? So let me tell you, RNA polymerase 1, RNA polymerase 2, RNA polymerase 3. Okay, listen very carefully. What is actually the function of RNA polymerase 1? RNA polymerase 1 transcribes ribosomal RNA. Write it down everywhere. Transcribes okay RNA polymerase 1 transcribes rRNA. So RNA polymerase transcribes rRNA. So one is correct. Second, RNA polymerase 2 transcribes mRNA. Mitochondrial RNA or mRNA, and also small regulatory RNA, sRNAs. Look, RNA polymerase 2 transcribes sRNA. Right? RNA polymerase 3 transcribes small RNA. Okay, small RNA molecules as well as tRNAs also. Okay, tRNAs also. So read the question very carefully now. RNA polymerase 1 transcribes rRNA, RNA polymerase 2 transcribes snRNA, RNA polymerase 2 transcribes hnRNA, given over. So 1 and 2 are correct, so option A is correct. Next time onwards, I would put out a timer so that we won't go like this. Because 1 hour, we have completed only 22. I think today we will be able to complete only 25 questions. Anyway, just bookmark this question, guys. Please bookmark this question. After you study genetics only, you start revising this. Okay, right now, just omit this. I think I'll provide you the PDF of the questions. Okay. And you'll continue with this in the next class. If you have any doubt with any of the questions over here, please ask me. Okay. Do this practice paper of 50 questions. Tell me your final marks. Okay. I'll provide the PDF of this question in the group. Our time is urging. I think you have a class at 11. No? Is it clear, Calvin? This is from the book which is in your hand itself, MTG at your fingertips. NCRT, MTG fingertips books. At last, you have three practice paper. So this is the first practice paper from that book. Okay, you can start doing the full length paper from that particular paper. The questions are a bit confusing, but no issue. How many marks after you write and evaluate yourself, then study it once again. Okay, actually, I've prepared everything. Right now, we are standing in which... we have total of 63 again. Okay, so thank you. See you in the next class with yet another supremely amazing session. So I'll be changing the thumbnail to 20 most expected. Okay, 20 most expected MCQs, because we haven't got time. If you guys were so active and well prepared, definitely we would have done more questions. So thank you guys. See you in the next class.